As we begin worship this morning, hear these words from Isaiah. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Good morning. Welcome to worship at Lawrenceville First Christian Church on this Epiphany Sunday. The long journey is over. The wise men have arrived. So let us all celebrate as the wise men did when they entered the house where Jesus was with his family. As we prepare to join in prayer now, let's take a moment to think about those we know who especially need our prayers. I especially ask you this morning to pray for Nettie Patterson and for Martha Ann Wages. Both of them have been in the hospital this week. We got an update this morning that Nettie is home. Martha Ann is still in the hospital. Neither one of them want visitors, but they do very much covet your prayers. So let's please remember them as we pray. And so as we go to God in prayer, if we will hold them close and also hold close others we know and also those we don't know who need God's presence today. Will you pray with me? Almighty and ever-living God, you revealed the incarnation of your Son by the brilliant shining of a star. Shine the light of your justice always in our hearts and over all lands, and accept our lives as the treasure we offer in your praise. As the prophet Isaiah called out, "Arise, shine, for your light has come." Empower your church, O God, to shout out the good news of the light of your Son Jesus, which pierces even the deepest darkness. As a star rose high into the nighttime sky to draw the nations to the Christ child, send your blessing, O God, on this nation and every nation, and draw the whole world to your peace. Like the Magi who traveled from afar to bring gifts and celebrate the Savior's birth, we pray for this community and for those who are celebrating their own birthdays and anniversaries, especially this week, Connie Worrell and Betty Higdon and Lisa Hopkins. As Jesus climbed the mountaintop and proclaimed blessings on the people of the world, we pray for the sick and the distressed, the poor and the lame. We especially pray for Nettie and for Martha Ann, that they will feel your presence and your love. As Jesus called his disciples to leave their nets and boats and follow him, we pray for those we love and who have answered your call to follow Jesus. Lord Jesus, light of the world, hear our prayers and make us reflections of your light. May this Epiphany season mark the beginning for each of us of a time of moving beyond what is reasonable and toward the star of wonder. Moving beyond grasping tight to what we have, to unclenching our hands and letting go, following the light wherever it leads. Moving beyond competition toward cooperation, seeing that all humans are sisters and brothers. Moving beyond the anxiety of small concerns toward the joys of justice and peace. Lord Jesus, light of the world, hear our prayers and make us reflections of your light, that the places of darkness in our world would be pierced by your light, and that all nations would be drawn to you and be overwhelmed with joy. Hear us now as we pray the prayer of your holy Son, Jesus the Messiah. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Would you join me in singing a couple of the Epiphany hymns that are in our hymn book? They're on page 172 and 173. We Three Kings, As With Gladness. And just to note, on We Three Kings, you only sing the refrain after the first and the fifth verse. So please stand, if you can, and let's sing together. So as I was thinking about Epiphany Sunday, songs about stars kept coming to mind. And those of you that know me well know that there's constantly a song in my head. And
it can be exhausting. But all these songs kept coming up, and here's some of them. Starlight, star bright, first star I see tonight. You know the rest. Are from a musical Les Mis. Stars in your multitudes, scarce to be counted, filling the darkness with order and light. You are the sentinels, silent and pure, keeping watch in the night. That's one of my favorites. Or my favorite musical, one of my very favorite musicals, is called Bright Star. It's pretty recent and was written by Steve Martin. And the theme for that goes, bright star, keep shining for me, shine on and see me through. Bright star, keep shining for me, and one day I'll shine for you. Well, all these songs made me wonder, how bright was the star that the wise men followed? It had to be amazing to lead them so far. Could it be called a blinding light? Oh no, that gets us into other songs. This bright light led them to Jesus. I heard a song while driving in the car, and I love the message it brings about a blinding light. It's called The Gospel by Ryan Stevenson. A restless generation, we're turning over every stone, hoping to find salvation in a world that's left us cold. Can we get back to the altar, back to the arms of our first love? There's only one way to the Father, and he's calling out in love. To the captive, it looks like freedom. To the orphan, it feels like home. To the skeptic, it might sound crazy to believe in a God who loves. In a world where our hearts are breaking and we're lost in the mess that we've made, like a blinding light in the dead of night, it's the gospel that makes a way. It's the cure for our condition. It's the good news for us all. It's greater than religion. It's the power of the cross. So can we get back to the altar, back to the arms of our first love? There's only one way to the Father, and he's calling out to us. In my own life, it means forgiveness when I know I deserved the fall. It called me out of my darkness and carried me to the cross. In a moment, my eyes were opened. In that moment, my heart was changed. Like a blinding light in the dead of night, it's the gospel that leads us home. Today, as we partake in communion, we behold this blinding light. We behold Jesus, the gospel. Jesus, the gospel who gives us hope and peace and joy and love. Jesus, the gospel, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of all the world. Come and receive forgiveness, grace, and love at this table. All are welcome.
Would you pray with me? Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you at this time where we will partake of the bread and the cup. We thank you for your Son, Jesus, and what his life, death, and resurrection means for us. We pray that you will bless this bread and this cup to the nourishment of our bodies and us to your service, so that we can go out into the world and do and show your love to everyone that we meet. For it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
on the night that Jesus was betrayed, while sitting and eating with his disciples, he took a loaf of bread and broke it and gave it to them and said, "Eat, this is my body broken for you. And likewise, after the meal, he took a cup and gave thanks and passed the cup amongst his disciples and said, "This is my blood shed for you for the new covenant." So.
It from the east. We've come so far to get here. We held our hope that we might find a king. How could we know that he would be God with us? Emmanuel, King of Israel, abides with us in this little boy. Who could know we'd find the eternal one born into time? This baby child is God with us. Him gold and frankincense and myrrh, when riches untold he left behind. We brought our best to celebrate a king who'd left his throne so he could become God with us. Emmanuel, come to us. The King of Israel abides with us in this little boy. Who could know we'd find mortal and mystery somehow intertwined? This baby boy is God with us. The Lord. In all my I never ever dreamed what this star was truly pointing toward, who this star was truly shining for. God with us, Emmanuel, come to us, the King of Israel abides with us in this little boy. Who could know we'd find mortal and mystery somehow intertwined? This baby boy is God with us.
Scripture comes from Matthew 2, verse 1 through 12. Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the reign of King Herod. But that time, some wise men from eastern lands arrived in Jerusalem asking, "Where is the newborn king of the Jews? We saw his star as it rose, and we have come to worship him." King Herod was deeply disturbed when he heard this, as was everyone in Jerusalem. He called a meeting of the leading priests and teachers of religious law and asked, "Where is the Messiah supposed to be born?" "In Bethlehem in Judea," they said, "for this is what the prophet wrote, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are not least among the ruling cities of Judea, for a ruler will come from you who will be the shepherd for my people, Israel.'" When Herod called for a private meeting with the wise men and he learned from them the time when the star first appeared, then he told them, "Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child, and when you find him, come back and tell me so that I can go and worship him too." From this interview, the wise men went their way, and the star they had seen in the east guided them to Bethlehem. It went ahead of them and stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. They entered a house and saw the child with his mother, Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasure chest and gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. When it was time to leave, they returned to their own country by another route, for God had warned them in a dream not to return to Herod. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Will you pray with me? Take my lips, O Lord, and speak through them. Take our minds and think with them. Take our hearts and set them on fire through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Have you noticed that for most of the world around us, the Christmas season has been over for a while? Families, homes, and stores start taking down their trees and stockings and lights on December 26th. And by New Year's Eve, celebrations and decorations of Christmas are a faint memory for many people. And yet we as a church are still celebrating the birth of our Messiah. This morning we celebrate an ancient holiday in Christianity, the Feast of the Epiphany. As you can see around you, the Christmas season is not quite over yet. The wise men who have been hanging out all season over here on the organ have finally arrived and are part of the nativity scene. And we, like millions of other Christians around the world, are greeting the arrival of the wise men with joy and excitement. Epiphany is an ancient celebration known in some parts of Appalachia as Old Christmas, because it happens on the date that was celebrated as Christmas in the ancient Julian calendar. I've always loved Epiphany, even as a child, but I grew to appreciate and love it even more during my time studying abroad in college. I spent a fall semester in Spain, in the town of Granada, down in the south, living with a family who ran a bread bakery. The family had three sons of elementary and middle school age, and those three boys made it their mission to educate me about everything in Spain. From counting pesetas, this was before the arrival of the euro, to dancing the Sevillana, which is a local dance a little like flamenco, to rolling my R's in Spanish, which I'm still not very good at. And as November came and went that fall, the boys taught me about Dia de los Reyes, their favorite day of the year. They celebrated Christmas in Granada, but it was mainly a religious holiday, a time to go to church and pray and sing. Los Reyes, as they called it, was the exciting celebration because it was the day they received most of their gifts. Like children everywhere, these boys debated about the best gifts and talked about what they hoped to receive. But I was surprised to hear them talk nearly as much about what they were planning to give others, including their parents, and their grandmother, their neighbor, and their neighbor Blanca. And as they told me more, I learned that Los Reyes, the gift-giving holiday, was celebrated on Epiphany, in honor of the wise men who brought gifts to the baby Jesus. What a fitting way to celebrate. Our scripture this morning is a familiar story to many of us, the tale of wise men from the east who followed a star to Jerusalem looking for the king of the Jews who had been born in nearby Bethlehem. It's funny how this story from Matthew has become mixed up with Luke's story of the birth of Jesus in the minds of many Christians, as if the shepherds and the wise men were coming and going in and out of the stable all on the same night. In reality, these are two completely different birth stories, told by different authors, writing for different audiences and different reasons. Matthew's birth narrative is full of wealthy characters, a king, the chief priests, and a group of men with enough wealth to travel a long distance following a star. How very different from Luke's story of a poor, exhausted couple, a baby born among animals, and a bunch of dirty, smelly peasants who tended sheep for a living showing up to visit the new baby. Matthew's story of the birth of Jesus was directed at a largely Jewish audience, and it was probably surprising to those who heard it. These men who traveled so far to visit the baby weren't Jewish leaders or even Jews themselves. And yet they were the ones, according to Matthew, who greeted this child with joy. This is a story about God's grace. God gives grace freely, and God gives that grace to everyone, Jews and Gentiles alike. So what do we actually know about the wise men of Matthew's gospel? These men were probably part of a priestly class of experts in the occult arts, such as astrology and dream interpretation. The Greek word that is translated wise men in some versions of the Bible has also been translated as astrologers, or in one source even wizards or sorcerers. We don't know exactly where these men came from other than the East. Some biblical scholars believe they were from Persia or Babylon. In any case, they journeyed a long way to follow that star, find the new Messiah, pay homage to him, and present their gifts. And they were definitely not part of the Jewish faith. Over the more than 2,000 years since Jesus was born, stories and legends have grown up around the wise men, and Christians have filled in details that are not in Matthew's gospel. We don't actually know that there were three wise men. We only know they gave Jesus three different types of gifts. It was not until the 700s that medieval Irish sources gave these men names and descriptions, and you see them kind of reflected in our nativity scene. Melchior, an old man with white hair and a long beard who brought gold. Balthazar, a beardless man with a ruddy complexion who brought frankincense. And Gaspar, a dark-skinned and heavily bearded man who brought myrrh. These are the three wise men that we see depicted in much of our art, many of our nativity scenes. These same Irish sources added their own interpretations to the gifts: gold for royalty, incense for worship and divinity, and myrrh for death and burial, symbols of Christ the King, Christ the divine Son of God, and Christ who was destined to die and be buried at the height of his ministry. These details add color to the story, but we have no idea if there's actually any truth to them. What we do know is that these wise men, who made a career of studying the stars, observed something unexpected, a star where there had not been a star before. And as Kim mentioned, probably a very bright star. And this was no ordinary star, but a miraculous star that came from God and signaled to them the arrival of a new king. Without doubt or hesitation or question, they dropped everything and followed this star. And this star, God's miraculous sign, did not behave like any other star they had ever seen. It moved ahead of them, guiding them to Jerusalem at exactly the right pace for them to keep up with it. When they got to Jerusalem, while they were trying to find out more information about the baby king they were seeking, the star stopped moving and stayed in place. When they had the information they needed and were ready to go on, the star began moving again. It kept moving ahead of them all the way to Bethlehem, and then stopped moving again when it was over the house where Jesus and his family were. Very unusual behavior for a star, and a reminder to the wise men and to us that this was no ordinary star, but rather a sign of God's grace. The wise men may have been surprised when the star appeared, but they recognized it as a sign from God. They dropped what they were doing in their everyday lives, and they followed God's guidance to find this most important child. We don't know exactly how long they traveled, because we don't know exactly where they were coming from. Some sources say the child Jesus may have been close to 2 years old by the time they arrived, again, depending on exactly where they came from. The trip took faithfulness and courage. It wasn't an easy or short journey. It was probably exhausting and lonely and likely dangerous in some places. And yet the wise men kept following that star. They recognized God's grace and set out entirely on faith at a great cost to themselves, both in time and in money. Last Sunday, Richard gave us 3 challenges for the new year. The first of which was to have faithfulness in challenging situations. Perhaps this story can help us as we seek to live out that challenge. We, the community of faith gathered at First Christian Church, may not be called on to travel long distances, but we are sure to face challenges as we continue to discern how to share God's grace, especially with people we don't know yet, who desperately need a message of hope. As Richard and I have preached many times, there's a big world outside our doors, a world full of people who need connections and relationships, a world where we can be the good news. Little actions, like meeting for dinner at Talpa's in December, are first steps, but there's so much more we can do and so much more God needs us to do. Stepping outside our comfort zone, spending time with people who are different from us, listening more than we talk, all of these things are challenging and scary. How can we act more like the wise men? How can we recognize God's surprising and unexpected signs of grace? And how can we respond faithfully, knowing God is with us? These are some of the biggest questions that face us as a congregation in 2023 and beyond. But it's also important to remember that the journey isn't the end of the story of the wise men. It's also important to remember what happened when they arrived at the house where Jesus and his parents were. How did they respond? With celebration and joy and praise. They paid homage to the child. In some versions, they bowed down and worshiped him, and they gave him gifts. They understood that they were foreigners, non-Jews, from far away, and yet they had received God's grace. They got to meet the Messiah. God's grace was there for the wise men, just as God's grace is here for everyone we know, you and me, our neighbors down the street, the children in Granada, Spain, who celebrated Los Reyes this past Friday, our Jewish and Muslim and Buddhist and atheist and agnostic siblings, everyone. God's grace is given to us. We don't have to ask for it. We don't have to do anything to earn it. Our job is to respond to that grace like the wise men did, with joy, celebration, excitement, and to help others see and celebrate God's grace in their own lives. January tends to be a time of year when we look at the world more seriously. The old year has ended, and we stop to consider what we accomplished and what we left undone. A new year has started, and society tells us it's time to buckle down, make resolutions, and commit to change what we don't like about ourselves and our lives. Save more money, get your house organized, or clean, or renovated. Read self-improvement books, spend less time on social media, eat more vegetables, give up alcohol, stop eating sweets, drink more water, try a new weight loss program, or join a gym, or buy a Peloton. All of these are admirable goals, and maybe you've chosen one or two of them as your goals for 2023. But what I think is missing from this suggested list of goals and ideas and resolutions is a sense of excitement. When we approach the world with such seriousness and determination, we may get things done, but we risk missing and overlooking the little moments of joy, of excitement, of celebration. So instead of asking you what you've resolved to change this year, I'm asking you, and I would love to know, what you're most excited about in the year that's just starting. And as a church, where do we hope to find joy, excitement, and celebration in 2023? Like the wise men, we may be surprised by God's grace and called to do challenging things when we least expect it. And like the wise men, we may find joy and grace in following God's call. It's scary, it's exciting. Are you ready? Are we ready? Thanks be to God for God's grace. Amen. And now, like the wise men, we have an opportunity to show our gratitude for God's grace through our tithes and our offerings. The money you give and the time and talents you share do so much good here at First Christian Church. We have the potential to continue to do so much more for our neighborhood, our broader community, and beyond, and we need the gifts of all of us to make it happen. Let us give thanks to God for all we have to share as we stand and sing the doxology. Be sure to stay after worship to help us undecorate the church. We need as many hands as possible to get everything packed up and put away. The Board and Leadership Council will have a joint meeting tonight starting at 6 on the usual church Zoom link. The board will participate for the first part of the meeting and then leave, and the Leadership Council will continue with some additional business they have. The CWF-DWF will meet Tuesday at 1 p.m. in the conference room. Sunday school will start next Sunday at 10 a.m. for children, youth, and adults. We encourage those of you who are not in the choir to come a few minutes early so we can start right at 10 o'clock. Mark your calendars for Tuesday, January 17th. That's the next Let's Eat gathering. Anna Harrison's working on a location. Talk to her if you have any ideas. We have some birthdays. We celebrate Connie Worrell's birthday, which was a week ago today on January 1st. Happy birthday, Miss Connie. We celebrate Betty Higdon's birthday, which was January 3rd. Happy birthday, Betty. And Lisa Hopkins also has a birthday coming up this coming Saturday, the 14th. So we celebrate with Lisa as well. Are there other announcements that I have missed? All right. If not, go in peace, go in joy, go in love, go in faith, go in hope. For the author of peace, joy, love, faith, and hope goes with you. May the grace of God that guided the wise men to Jesus be your guiding light and your shining star, both now and forevermore. Amen.